Good afternoon. Between the PBS NewsHour, twice weekly columns for the New York Times, several books, including one coming out next month, David? David Brooks comes to this crisis of democracy and journalism with thoughtfulness and perspective. Those of you who might have watched or listened to one of his TED Talks or perhaps read his column on Monday might understand why one of my colleagues said, ah, he's become America's lay theologian. David is a perfect bookend, I think, for this conference in which Knight has so ably examined our current malaise and the possible ways forward. His writing touches on much of what this conference has talked about, and particularly as I looked at his work, thought about Grant Oliphant's very, very moving luncheon speech. And I would just say, David, if you ever have writer's block, take a look at that transcript. It might give you some ideas. I don't think you do, but it's there. Deconstructing the recent Covington Catholic High School controversy, which was horribly mangled by the media, David began with this sobering observation. Within living memory, political polarization had at least something to do with issues. This is a horribly low threshold for the good old days. In my experience, polarization, even around policies, rarely leads to anything constructive. But the comment did catch my eye. I worked in cabinet positions in two states for two progressive Republican governors, I would correct myself. And in those roles, I managed billions of dollars, literally managed them. Yet in 16 years, not once did anyone ever suggest that I do anything other than what I believe to be in the public interest. Our expectations for public leadership have really changed. The phrase in living memory forces us all to see just how much ground we have all ceded. In living memory, we had expectations that there was high-performance government. In living memory, we recall frequent episodes of constructive political debate. In living memory, trusted civic institutions illuminated and energized political debate and compromise. This rapid erosion that we've experienced has been stunning. I think the thing about in living memory reminds us that as the generations pass, the living memory will be of the way we are living today, and that's pretty frightening. David has been a calm, though I have to say not necessarily reassuring, voice in an era of turbulence. In trenchant columns last month, he correctly identified social media as the accelerant of tribalism, personal destruction, and shaming. He wrote, "The crucial thing is that the nation's culture is now enmeshed in a new technology that we don't know how to control. It has enabled binary thinking in which people are categorized as good or evil." Dana Boyd's talk yesterday AM was chilling on its demonstration of the manipulation of news and public thought. Binary polarization driven by technology has challenged every major journalism organization, has reshaped the political spectrum. I'm a lifelong registered Republican who rarely finds a Republican to vote for. I'm not going to quit voting, but I really do understand the indifference that many people now feel toward our political institutions. David captured my sense of loss when last year he observed that Americans have lost faith in big institutions. Many fly to the extremes. The rest of us feel adrift, gloomy, and politically homeless. What a telling phrase. Politically homeless. I imagine David's words resonate with a lot of people here. We have so few voices in the public square able to articulate a worldview for the politically homeless and for the value of moderation. But he is not all gloom. He counters our current dysfunction with a confidence that this country has survived many difficult moments of transition when an old order quit working. And he says, people figure it out. The young people may figure it out. Wherever he can, David encourages us to look for workable models that balance competing needs. He asks us to remember that many nations with the freest markets also provide generous safety nets. I won't elaborate on that seeming contradiction. You can find that column in the New York Times archive for December 20th. It simply underscores the notion that if leaders are willing, they can find ways to weld together sound, inclusive public policies that restore belief and compromise. We have not yet found the voices compelling enough, or I should mention, search optimized enough, to get the attention of leaders and to reward those who seek principled compromise. And Jennifer, you're on to something. Journalists in the room, get on YouTube. I'll end with an observation David made about his role in the national conversation. I went into journalism to cover politics, but now I find myself in national marriage therapy. Covering American life is like covering one of those traumatizing Eugene O'Neill plays about a family where everybody screams at each other all night, and then when dawn breaks, you get to leave the theater. Only right now, we can't leave the theater. So David, please come and help us find the exit.
Thank you, Feather. When I was 25, I got to know a moderate Republican senator named Dave Durenberger from Minnesota. And every time I see him, I think, you know, he told me, you know, you should become a moderate Republican. That's where the future is. I said, thanks, Senator Durenberger. That really worked out for me and for Feather. I'd also like to salute whoever left those two rings in the washroom to make such a dramatic life choice at this conference. Something to be encouraged. I'm going to talk about dramatic life choices and moral renewal, both personal moral renewal and I think our country's moral renewal. And I'll start by talking about one journalist, the one I know best, which is myself. I decided to go into journalism at age 7. I read a book called Paddington the Bear, and I decided, you know, I'm going to write. That's what I want to do. I remember in high school, I wanted to date a woman named Bernice. She didn't want to date me. She wanted to date some other guy. And I remember thinking, what is she thinking? I write way better than that guy. And so we had different values. And then when I was 18, I went to a very cerebral school. The admissions officers at Wesleyan, Columbia, and Brown decided I should go to the University of Chicago, which is a Baptist school where atheist professors teach Jewish students St. Thomas Aquinas. That's the best phrase about that. And so I started writing. I wrote for the school paper. I double majored in history and celibacy while I was there. And I met a guy named William F. Buckley who offered me a job. And that was how journalism started, and now I've gone on. I'm a conservative columnist at the New York Times, which is a job I liken to being chief rabbi at Mecca. Not a lot of company there. And I work for the PBS NewsHour, where I'm very proud to work. We have a great audience, a somewhat seasoned audience. So if a 93-year-old lady comes up to me in the airport, I know what she's going to say. I don't watch your show, but my mother loves it. We're very big in the hospice community there. And books and writing and columns have been my life. I've gotten a little more feminine as I've gotten older. I'm the only American man who finished that book, Eat, Pray, Love, if you've read that one. By page 123, I was actually lactating, which was amazing. And then I wrote this book, which was in your bags, on character. And I learned that writing a book on character doesn't give you good character, and even reading a book on character doesn't give you good character. But buying a book on character does give you good character, and so I recommend that. Now, the thing about journalism is that a lot of us have an aloof personality type. I tell journalism students, if you're at a football game and everyone else is doing the wave, and you don't do the wave, you have the right kind of aloof personality to be a journalist. Because we're not actually in the game, we're watching the game. A certain emotional reserve is sometimes useful in that work, because we want to be distant and we want to be objective and we want to be outside the game. And that could lead to a lack of connection in our personalities. And certainly in mine, I always like the old Gary Shandling line, my friends tell me I have an intimacy problem, but they don't really know me. And so that kind of emotional reserve, then you're in the business of writing. And the business of writing is profoundly a lonely business. John Cheever had an apartment in New York. He would get up in the morning, he would put on a suit, he would take the elevator down to the basement where he had an office, he would take off a suit, he would write in his boxers till noon, put back on the suit, ride the elevator up to his apartment, and that was his day, all alone. And then if you succeed, it's weirdly more isolating still. The book that was in your bags did reasonably well, so I went on a long book tour of 99 days. And I counted at one point in the stretch 42 meals eaten alone, either on an airport, airplane, or hotel room. And so it was weirdly solitary, even though I was socially exhausted. And around that time, I saw a picture of Britney Spears going wacko and shaving off all her hair. And I remember like, yeah, I could do that. I'm like, I get that. And then we're all infected by a culture of hyper-individualism that says life is an individual journey. I want to be free to be myself. I want to be self-sufficient, self-actualizing. I want to look after my own personal happiness. And then we're all infected by a meritocracy that defines our lives by what we achieve. Gives you brands to attach you to, your prestigious school, your nice job titles. It organizes society into a bunch of inner rings. It doesn't mean to, but it really tells the message that people who achieve more are worth a little more than people who achieve less. And it gives us this chance to be workaholics. And I found that workaholism is a surprisingly effective distraction from any spiritual or moral problem. And so the wages of sin are sin, and you wind up in the ditch. For me, the ditch came around 2013. My kids were leaving home. My marriage had broken up. I was sort of humiliated by that, and pained as anybody would be. I came to see that I had come to idolize time over people. So every time I had a relationship, it was, I needed to move on because I had stuff to do. And if you went to my kitchen, all I had really was work. So if you went to, I lived in an apartment, and if you went to my kitchen in the apartment and you opened the drawers, where there should be silverware, there were Post-it notes. Where there should be plates, there were stationery and envelopes, because work had become the consuming thing. And so when you're in the valley, you begin to learn things. And three big things I learned in that valley about how you turn around and how a nation turns itself around. First, freedom sucks. I had complete freedom. I had the economic and the identity of a 52-year-old and the open options of a 22-year-old. And it totally sucked. Political freedom is great, journalistic freedom is great, but social and personal freedom, being untied down to others, being adrift, totally sucks. Freedom is not an ocean you want to live in, it's a river you want to get through so you can commit to something on the other side. Because the uncommitted person is the unremembered person, because they're not really attached to anything. The second thing I learned is that when you're down in the valley, when you have one of those seasons, you can either be broken or you can be broken open. The people who are broken get smaller and more afraid. They lash out with anger, with grievance, resentment toward the world. As the saying goes, pain that is not transformed gets transmitted. But other people are broken open. And the most toughest time of their life becomes the defining feature of their life. Paul Tillich, a 1950s theologian, said what suffering does is it reminds you you're not the person you thought you were. It comes as an interruption to life, and it carves through what you thought was the floor of the basement of your soul, and it carves through that and reveals a cavity below that, and it carves through that and reveals a cavity below that. And you realize that only spiritual and emotional food can fill those cavities. And so what happens in moments of suffering, I think both nationally and personally, is you get to know yourself a lot better. When Donald Trump won election, we got to know our country a lot better. And you discover in the depths that Tillich describes, first, you get out of, people like me, you get out of your head, you discover your heart and the desires of the heart. I read about a guy recently who bought a home with a bamboo stand by the driveway, and he hated bamboo. So he chopped it down, took an axe to the root system, poured plant poison in, 3 feet of gravel, 6 inches of concrete. 2 years later, little shoot of bamboo coming up. And in my view, we all have that. We all have a sense of desire. If you go to see an eighth grade play or a four-year-old's at a play, in a school play, you see the fervency of their desire. Sometimes life tries to cover over that desire, but it shoots through. And what we all desire, what the heart desires most, is a sense of completion and fusion with one another. The kind of fusion that Louis de Bernier described in this book, Captain Corelli's Mandolin. He had an old guy talking to his daughter about his relationship with his late wife. And he says, love itself is what is left over when being in love is burned away. And this is both an art and a fortunate accident. Your mother and I had it. We had roots that grew towards each other underground. And when all the pretty blossoms had fallen from our branches, we found that we were one tree and not two. I think that's what we want. The second most important part of our consciousness that you discover in those moments is the yearning soul. Now, I'm a lay theologian, not an actual theologian, so I don't ask you to believe in God or not believe in God. That's not my department. But I do ask you to believe that you have a soul. I ask you to believe that you have some piece of you which has no size, weight, color, or shape, but is of infinite value and dignity, and that rich and successful people don't have more of it than poor or less successful people, that slavery is wrong because it's an obliteration of another person's soul, that rape is not just an attack on a bunch of physical molecules, it's an attack on another human being's soul. Obscenity is defined as anything that covers over another person's soul. And what the soul does is it gives us moral responsibility, but it also gives us this desire to lead good lives. A lot of us who are journalists cover a lot of bad people. I've covered genocide, wars, criminals. I've never met anybody who didn't want to lead a good life. And even people who do bad things have some rationalization. As the heart yearns for fusion with another, the soul yearns for fusion with an ideal. The kind of ideal that Rabbi Wolf Kelman described. He marched in Selma with Dr. King. And of that experience, he wrote, "We felt connected in song to the transcendental, to the ineffable. We felt triumph and celebration. We felt that things change for the good and nothing is congealed forever. That was the most warm transcendental spiritual experience. Meaning and purpose and mission were beyond exact words. Meaning was the feeling, the song, the moment of overwhelming spiritual fulfillment." So in these dark moments, you become aware of your higher desires that are better than the shallow desires. And then you become aware of the third big thing is the problem you're facing is not going to be solved on the same level at which you created it. You have to go down to a different level. So these are all personal reflections. But as that was happening, I was looking around the country, as we all were, and seeing the country go into a ditch, a social ditch, which had a lot to do with mine, really. It was about social loss of connection. It was about hyper-individualism. It was an obsessive concern for the meritocracy. We've had 60 years of individualism in this country, and we sort of run out the string on that one. We've weakened the connections between us. 35% of Americans over 45 are chronically lonely. 50% of Americans say no one knows them well. In 1970, married couples entertained friends in their home on average 15 times a year. Now it's 8 times. Only 8% of Americans say they have meaningful conversations with their neighbors. The fastest growing political party is unaffiliated. The fastest growing religious movement is unaffiliated. Since 1999, suicide rates have shot up by 30%. Among those 7 to 17, suicide rates among girls have shot up 70%. 45,000 Americans kill themselves each year, and suicide is a proxy for loneliness. 72,000 die from opiate addictions, and that's just slow motion suicide. Twice as many deaths every year from these deaths of despair than the entire Vietnam War. American lifespan is declining, not rising. Second, distrust of each other and our institutions. Earlier generation, 75% of Americans said they trusted their institutions, including the media. Now we're down to less than 20%. Distrust of each other. If you ask people a generation ago, do you trust the people around you? 60% said yes. Now it's 32% who say my neighbors are trustworthy, and only 19% of millennials. The younger you go, the more distrustful they are. And as Bob Putnam of Harvard says, that's not a perception, that's reality. That's because the least trustworthy they are. The third is sort of a spiritual or psychological crisis. It's amazing to me, given all we know, that mental health problems are on the increase, not the decrease, that depression rates are skyrocketing, that if you go to any college, mental health facilities are overwhelmed. I see it in the young people I teach. They get out of school, something bad happens, and they call me, and they're cratered. Nietzsche has a phrase, he who has a why to live for can endure anyhow. If you know why you're doing something, you can handle the setbacks. If you don't know the why, you can't handle it, and you crater. I see it in middle-aged people. I have a friend, Casey Gerald, who just wrote a very good book, who was being interviewed for a job, and he turned it around and asked the interviewer a question, and the question was a very good one, which I now ask people. What would you do if you weren't afraid? And she started crying, because if she wasn't afraid, she wouldn't be doing HR at that company. And so you see this depression, and when you leave human beings naked and alone, they do what their evolutionary roots tell them to do. They revert to tribe. Tribalism seems like community, it's a way to bond, but it's really the dark twin of community. Community is based on mutual affection. Tribalism is based on mutual hatred and shared hatred. It's a high perception of threat. It's an us versus them, zero-sum mentality, a scarcity mentality. Politics is war, distrust is the worldview, ideas are combat, erect walls, build barriers, destroy the offenders. I mentioned the problem of our country. Our ideology is that half the country imagines they can destroy the other half and then get everything they want. And that will never happen. And so this is a collapse. And Paul Steiger and I are sitting together. When I worked for the Wall Street Journal, I covered the world in the early 90s. And I covered great news. I was based in Brussels. I covered the fall of Berlin Wall, the end of the Soviet Union, Oslo peace process, Mandela coming out of prison in South Africa. Great. The last thing I covered, I barely paid attention to, was the Yugoslav Civil War. And in retrospect, that was the most important story I covered, because the ensuing 25 years have been about ethnic nationalism, rising strife, and authoritarian leadership. And so how do you recover? Well, go back to my personal story. It's a four-step process. The first is a culture has to be willing to be broken open, to go down to a deeper level. There's this parable in the Bible, Moses is out being a shepherd after he's killed the Egyptian soldier before God's called him back. And there's a lamb that runs away from him like a gazelle. Lambs don't usually run like gazelles, but this one did. And he has to chase it deeper into the wilderness. And the rabbis tell us that the lamb was Moses himself. Sometimes you have to go deeper in the wilderness and become a new person and change your mindset and change your culture to actually do what you need to do after a setback. Annie Dillard writes, "In the deeps are the violence and terror of which psychology has warned us. But if you ride these monsters down, if you drop with them farther over the world's rim, you find what our sciences cannot locate or name, the substrate, the ocean or matrix of ether which buoys all the rest, which gives goodness its power for good and evil its power for evil, the unified field, our complex and inexplicable caring for each other." And I just want to highlight that last phrase. If you get down to the bottom of most of us, red or blue, you find our inexplicable caring for each other. And I do think it, basically most people just want to be loved. Even Michael Cohen, who I was watching this morning. Then the second stage two is when you're in a dark time, you have to be willing to be led. In my view, people can rarely get themselves out of seasons of suffering, but there are others who are reaching down, trying to grab them and lift them up. That happened to me when I was in my dark time. I got invited over to a home of a couple named Kathy and David. They had a kid in DC public schools, and he had a friend whose mom had some health and drug issues, so he was homeless. So they said, well, James can stay with us. And then James had a friend, and James had a friend. And 5 years ago, that first day I walked into their house, there were 25 kids around the dinner table and 15 sleeping in the basement. And I reached out to introduce myself to one of the kids, and he said, we don't really shake hands here. We hug here. And I'm not the huggiest guy on the face of the earth, but I've been going there every Thursday for 5 years and just hugging. And what we do is we sit around the table and we talk about what happened that week, what we're grateful for. We throw stuff on the table. A kid passes the GED exam, gets a barber's degree. Some suffering from depression, they throw that on the table. One of the young women had a failed kidney, and so David gave her one of his. And I brought an old guy who's been doing youth work for 70 years, a guy named Bill Milliken, who does communities and schools. And he said, I've been doing this 50 years. I've never seen a program turn around a life. I only see relationships turn around lives. And that's what gets created at this community. And whenever I would go, I would write my column, and then I'd go to dinner, and I'd realize this is the answer to everything I'm writing about. And those people are everywhere. A year ago, I started a project at the Aspen Institute called Weave, the Social Fabric Project, and weavers are everywhere. We drop into a place like Wilkesboro, North Carolina, we find 100 of them. Met a woman named Aisha Butler in Englewood in Chicago. She was moving out of Englewood because it's so dangerous. The day she moved out, she saw two little girls throwing broken bottles in an empty lot across the street, and she said, I'm not leaving that. She told her husband, we're not going to be just another family that left. Now she's a big community leader in Englewood. I met a woman in Ohio whose husband killed their kids and himself, and she now has a pharmacy school. She teaches at Ohio University. She has a foundation. She said, I grew from this experience because I was angry. I was going to fight back against what he tried to do to me and make a difference in the world. See, he didn't kill me. My response to him is, whatever you meant to do to me, fuck you, you're not going to do it. So a lot of these people have a bright sadness. and they see reality, they see the shadow because they're right in the middle of life, but they are bright about it. And whether they were red or blue, they had similar language. They had vocational certitude. They all knew this is why I was put on this earth. They had walkout experiences where they had to leave corrupt experiences. They used the phrase like radical hospitality, radical mutuality. We're all broken, we're all equal here. It's, as we listened to them, we realized they are a movement that doesn't know it's a movement. And they are reaching in and trying to help us out. There's a woman I met named Mary Gordon who runs a program called Roots of Empathy. And what they do is they take infants and mothers, put them in eighth grade classrooms, and the kids have to analyze what the infant is doing as a way to get in the mind of the infant. And one day there was a kid named Darren who'd been held back for 2 years. He was much bigger than everybody else, a little scary looking. And he asked the mom if he could hold the infant. And the mom was nervous because he looked scary. But she said yes, and it turned out Darren was fabulous with the infant. He clutched it on his chest, and he rocked it, and he handed it back, and he started asking all these questions about fatherhood, the last of which was, if nobody has ever loved you, do you think you can be a good father? And so these people are just reaching out into that world and trying to build community. And so the third step is, what can we do as journalists and storytellers to bend the culture around them? Culture changes when a small group of people find a better way to live and other people try to copy them. These weavers have found a better way to live. And they're healing society where it's hurting the most at the most foundational level. They're living out an ideology, which is that we're not hyper-individualist, we're formed by relationship, we live for our relationship, we measure the quality of our lives by the quality of our relationships. And society shifts when the culture shifts. The relationships they're building take a long time to build, and they're very local. So relationships don't scale, but norms scale. If you can tell the stories about somebody and shifts the culture and the mindset and shifts the norms, then behavior changes across society. It happened in the 60s, it happened in the 30s, it happens again and again. And so all of us can tell their stories. All of us can change our behavior a little. Invite a neighbor out to dinner, stop stereotyping. A lot of our business's bad faults come from very bad sociology. When we socialize other people and name and do all these things about them and they feel insulted. So my takeaways from doing this work at Weave is, one, the answer is local. And this conference, it's heartening for me to see a conference full of people who are focusing on these local. Second, we need to go down and report on the relationships that are being built. It's easy for us in journalism to report on the political level and on the who, what, when level. But the quality of the relationships is what matters in a place, and that's hard to capture. Solutions journalism does it, but it is the story that needs to be told. Third, there has to be a town story. Communities are people who share a sense of story. And some towns we went into had a story. They knew who they were, they knew where they were going, they knew how they were behaved, and they know where they're going. A lot of stories, they don't have a town story. Or else the town story was the dominant story 50 years ago, and the new stories have not been included in that dominant story. And so how great would it be if local NPR or local TVs or local newspapers could do, frankly, what they did unconsciously before, which is to say, what is our town story? Let's get together and name our story. Because if you don't have a story that you're part of, you don't know how to behave. The final thing that we could help out is to name the town project. Rabbi Jonathan Sacks wrote a book in which he pointed out that in the book of Genesis, the description of the creation of the world takes place in 9 verses. The creation in Exodus of the tabernacle takes hundreds and hundreds of verses. Why does that take so much? Because in Exodus, the Jews were being formed into a people, and a people is something who builds something together. You gotta have common construction projects. And all these are different from town to town. We were in Youngstown, Ohio, where they have too many houses, so they're tearing it down. The next day I went to Aurora, Colorado. They don't have enough houses, they're building them up. It's all different, but there's always one project that unites people. And so as Feather said, my main conviction is that we figure stuff out. And the thing I walk away from these weavers is a sense of their joy. Happiness is what you feel when you win some victory and your self expands. But joy is what you feel when you transcend self and you lose the sense of where you end and somebody else begins. It's in a mother and a daughter. It's in people dancing. It's in neighbor on neighbor. It's in people sacrificing for a common cause. And then joy is not a sensation, it becomes an outlook, a permanent state. And so as I went around and were with these people, I saw this expression, which frankly I don't see in the Times newsroom a lot, which is just an explosion of joy. And if we orient our lives toward joy and not individual happiness, we'll be pointing in the right direction. Thank you.
David has graciously offered to do some Q&A, so if there are some questions, if anyone has a question, we will welcome that, or we will close the program. Questions? Any questions? Quiet group. Yep. And then.
Hi, David. My name is Matt Hagman, formerly worked at Knight Foundation. All that you are talking about, remarkable, deeply moving, and I can't wait to read your book. How, though, does this translate into our politics? I mean, it's just, how do we make that leap? And I obviously, starting at the grassroots and community organizations and our and relationships with one another, but sort of, can you talk a little bit about how that ultimately translates into finding our politics in a better place?
Before I answer the question, let me do something extraordinarily stupid, which I meant to do. One of the things we're trying to do at Weave is just trying to magnify local stories. And a lot of people in this room are attached to, are making those local stories, funding those local stories, supporting those local stories. And we want to tell the kind of stories that'll change the culture, at least just spread them around if they've already been told. So I'm going to give you my email, which I shouldn't do. But this is the email that literally goes on my phone. It's david.brooks@aspeninstitute.org. And I will literally see that. And if you can think of any way we can help you tell stories and get the stories out there, please send me an email. Now as for politics, I'm a big fan of Putnam, Bob Putnam at Harvard, who I mentioned. He points out that we went through something similar like this in the 1890s to 1910. We had a super individualistic culture. We had a big economic transition. We had a big wave of immigration. We had a lot of political corruption. And society turned itself around. And it did it, Putnam says, and I wouldn't want to replicate everything, there were ugly parts of the 1890s, but it did it in three phases. The first was a spiritual and cultural shift. Basically, social Darwinism, which was super individualistic, was replaced by the social gospel movement. And so you had a shift there. And then you had a civic revolution. So within a few years, you had the creation of the Boys and Girls Clubs, the Boys and Girls Scouts, the Settlement House movement, the environmental movement, the temperance movement, the NAACP, the labor unions. You had all this organizing. People rallied at the local level. And then eventually, all those diverse movements said, hey, we're all part of one thing, and it could be political. Let's call it the progressive movement. So the trajectory was cultural first, civic second, political third. And I think that has to be how it's going to happen, because believe me, it ain't going to happen with politics first. That's just not how it happens.
Thank you. One more question.
Thank you very much. I haven't read the book yet, but I'm going to read it on the plane. Did you think about theology as a young person, theology and philosophy? Or did this all spring upon you in your night of darkness?
I would say as I got older, I was interested in philosophy, but it was something, it was like handy usefulness for life. I was big and the books I was reading were small. And as you get older, a couple things happen to you. First, the amplitude at which you experience life becomes so wide, your categories for it are inadequate. And basically, the normal categories of the newspaper We look politics, economics, those are our normal categories. That was inadequate to experience as I was really experiencing it. And I basically think our media culture is over-politicized and under-moralized. We spend too much on each poll and not enough on the things that really matter, which are our character, relationships, the things that would really define our lives. And so I tried to use my column as a little way to shift that. And I will say, before Trump, my readership exploded when I wrote a spiritual or personal column. Now it's not like that anymore. Now if you write about Trump or you're down. Trump has monopolized, and you're fighting upstream if you write about anything that's more important. But for me, it was not a moment. Like, it would have been great if, like, God had knocked on my door, turned my water into wine, and said, I'm here. My process has been so slow and gradual, it's like watching a lake evaporate. But as life gets bigger and older, you get softer somehow. I've now turned to spiritual books in the way I just never did, but it's been a super gradual evolution. Thank you all very much.
Thank you very much.